Good evening. It is my pleasure to welcome you all to On Topic with President Ken Starr with our honored guest, Mr. Juan Williams. I am Catherine Illingworth, and I'm Baylor's inaugural presidential fellow. Dr. Elizabeth Davis, Executive Vice President and Provost, is representing Baylor at another event tonight. So it is my honor to introduce to you Dean David Garland, who will begin his term as Baylor University's interim provost on June 3rd. Dr. Garland is Dean of the George W. Truett Theological Seminary and Professor of Christian Scriptures. I now invite him forward to introduce our distinguished guest. Thank you.
Good evening. It's my pleasure to welcome you tonight on topic with President Ken Starr. Our on topic events bring to Baylor individuals with significant perspectives on a variety of issues. Our desire is that the exchange between our president and world-renowned experts will stimulate dialogue on issues vital to us all. We're privileged tonight to welcome Mr. Juan Williams, an award-winning journalist, author, and political analyst. Mr. Williams was born in Colon, Panama. He moved to the United States to attend school and earned his bachelor's degree from Haverford College. Mr. Williams started his career as a reporter and served for 23 years at the Washington Post as an editorial writer, op-ed columnist, national correspondent, and White House correspondent. As an African-American journalist in a mostly white newsroom covering White House affairs, he gained a unique perspective, especially on race relations and civil rights. He covered every major political campaign from 1980 to 2000, and he's interviewed each of the past five presidents of the United States. He spent a decade at National Public Radio, first as host of Talk of the Nation, and then as senior news analyst. Since 1997, Mr. Williams has also been a contributor at Fox News. He is currently co-host for a show called The Five, where he's one of seven rotating Fox personalities. Additionally, he serves as Fox News Channel political analyst, a regular panelist on Fox News Sunday, and special report with Brett Baer. And he's a regular substitute host for the O'Reilly Factor. Mr. Williams has received several awards for his writing and investigative journalism. He's the author of seven books, including the bestseller, Eyes on the Prize, American Civil Rights Years, 1954 to 1965, and Thurgood Marshall, American Revolutionary. He has written numerous articles for national magazines, including Time, Fortune, The Atlantic Monthly, The New Republic, Ebony, and GQ, and is a regular contributor to TheHill.com, which reports on cutting-edge news from Capitol Hill. Mr. Williams' insight and perspective on politics and culture are critically important, and we are honored to host him on our campus. Will you please join me in offering a warm welcome to our guest, Mr. Juan Williams.
Here, here. Thank you, Dean Garland. And I know Elizabeth wants very much to be here. She has had a long-standing commitment to the good people of Central Texas and the lovely city of Temple. She's the featured speaker, so I know she's here in spirit as we think rather fondly of Elizabeth in these waning days of her service as Executive Vice President and the Provost, as she heads off to Furman University to be president of that wonderful university. So we wish Elizabeth Godspeed as well. Juan, welcome back to Baylor University.
Hey, it's a pleasure to be here. Thank you all.
We're gonna turn Juan into a Baylor Bear yet. We're gonna teach him how to sick 'em and all that. But this is not his first rodeo, as we say. He has been here before, was wildly popular, but it's the first time you've been to campus since Alice and I have been privileged and blessed to be here at Baylor University, older than the state of Texas itself. Just a few preliminary words. Today is May the 1st. It is the National Day of Prayer. Back in 1775, the Second Continental Congress, as they were looking ahead to the Declaration and to the war likely to come, gathered together and determined that there should be a national day of prayer and fasting. And so it has been in America ever since, virtually, not entirely, but virtually without interruption. And so it was this very morning at 10 a.m. Eastern Time, the President of the United States issued a very elegant proclamation. And I commend it to everyone, those of faith in particular, but even those who do not feel called to a life of faith will find the President's words, I hope, very moving and inspiring, because he does talk about freedom for all persons, whether they're people of faith or not. But isn't it wonderful to live in a country where we can celebrate the National Day of Prayer? Yes, by all means. It's also Law Day. Now, you may not get quite as excited about that, but I do. I get really excited about it. I can't say that Law Day, I know, I've not seen any bumper stickers here in Waco, have you hugged your lawyer today? Those are pretty popular in Washington, D.C., but in any event, Law Day is a much more recent origin. It was President Eisenhower, really at the height of the Cold War, this iconic hero of World War II, a former university president himself, as well as a renowned military leader. Determined that there should be, I mean, it was his idea, that there should be a law day. He wasn't a lawyer himself, but as he was thinking about the world and geopolitical considerations, he said there needs to be a law day. And what he said was this: today, we join our fellow Americans and I'm sorry, let me turn back. I skipped over something here. And it is not showing. Usually I'm better prepared than this. Here it is. In a very real sense, the world no longer has a choice between force and law. If civilization is to survive, it must choose the rule of law. And when we think about what's happening geopolitically and force being used, these words of President Eisenhower come ringing home. This is also an anniversary year, the 50th anniversary of the passage of a vitally important law, the landmark 1964 Civil Rights Act. And we're going to talk about that, and we're going to do so against the backdrop of that which we all see, we witness it, Juan lives in it, and that's highly polarized Washington, D.C. This also marks the 60th anniversary of the greatest Supreme Court opinion in the 20th century, Brown versus Board of Education. And that case, as I hope we all learned as school children, condemned the evil regime of separate but equal. Separate was not equal, but in any event, it was wrong. And it was successfully argued, of course, by one of the greatest lawyers of the 20th century and one of the great judges and justices of the 20th century, Thurgood Marshall. So how appropriate that Juan Williams has returned to Baylor on this special day, the National Day of Prayer. And I wanted to hold up one of Juan's wonderful books, This Far by Faith. This Far by Faith. And this is a story about how, in fact, let me read from Marion Wright Edelman, the president of Children's Defense Fund. This Far by Faith is a rich historical overview of the key role religion always played in black life and the different ways in which African Americans over the centuries have called on faith to see them through. And then for Law Day. Law Day as we celebrate the fact that we are, as John Adams famously said, a government of laws and not a government of men. And by the way, if you didn't see it, I hope that you can go back. I still have my hard copy of last Sunday's Waco Tribune Herald and the magnificent interview that Bill Whitaker had with Juan. And the headline is, it's a full-page interview. It's just marvelous. Past glories, present gridlock. And that's where we will begin. One. The contemporary scene in Washington, it's pretty bad. It seems to be pretty ugly. How bad is it?
Pretty bad. Let me begin by thanking you, Judge Starr and Alice, for inviting me, and just say what an honor it is to be back at Baylor. First time I came more than 10 years ago when KWBU was getting started. Mm. And I think they're having their spring fundraiser. Be nice. and just so pleased to be on the campus. It is growing, and clearly growing during your tenure. I think you've been a blessing to the school. So
thank you.
It's been just a pleasure to be here.
Thank you.
And also, let me just say, the weather, wow, you can't beat it. You know, I've just come out of a deluge on the East Coast. It's raining unbelievably. And before that, we had just terribly cold winter. Some people said to me today, well, how cold was it? I said, it was so cold the politicians were walking around with their hands in their own pockets. It was that cold. It was terrible. And then this afternoon, I had the pleasure at a reception to meet some folks, to say hello to people. And again, you know, some people remembered me from earlier visits here. And I remember when I simply was a voice on the radio, people would say it's nice to put a face with the voice that they hear on the radio. Of course, I'd say I didn't know what you look like either. But now that I work for Fox and I'm on TV, the other day somebody said to me at one of these receptions, it's great to be able to put a body with a talking head. Well, I'd never heard that before. It made me think, I hope she likes the body, you know? So, to come to your question, Judge Starr, how bad is it? You know, I think that it's so frustrating for me because I don't think that these are evil people. I don't think these are people who you would sit with and say, what a stupid man or woman. But I think they find themselves locked into a kind of political gridlock that does not allow the best of their aptitude or their spirit to show through. I think this is also a reflection of us as the American people here in 2014. If you think back over our history in recent years, clearly there's some bridges to this frozen, gridlocked, paralyzed land that we live in at the moment. I would begin in part with the 2000 election. Everybody remembers it, how quickly things became separated, alienated, Democrats versus Republicans, arguments over the very outcome, the Supreme Court involved in that case. Then you go forward to 2004, after 9/11 had somewhat brought us together as an American people, but you go right back to the polarization when it comes to 2004, accusations against President Bush for his motives for going into Iraq, charges against then-candidate Kerry on the Democratic side. Remember, he was swift-boated, said he wasn't as loyal and courageous as he had made himself out to be in Vietnam. Such a bitter election. And then you come forward in time, and we go through the economic crisis of 2008, and again, people angry at Wall Street, angry at the bankers, angry at corporate America, a lot of that sense of jealousy, anger, class divide. And then you come again to the arguments over health care, the Tea Party. Meanwhile, you have Occupy. You see these kinds of divisions throughout the body politic. So it's not just that the paralysis is located in one area. It's as if it's metastasized. It's all through the body politic. And I would also throw in there, Judge, the idea that people like me, people in the media, contribute to this polarization. I think it's now the case that we don't so much broadcast the news as we narrowcast the news. We find specific audiences and we play to their preferences. We give people the opportunity to affirm pre-existing opinions in many cases. And the result is that, well, from, you know, given what I do, I think of it in these terms. We're losing a common language because we're losing common stories, and we don't know each other through those common stories in the way that we did a generation ago. So if someone tells me, for example, that, you know, they read the Wall Street Journal, or that they are big Rush fans and listen to Fox, I know that person's political outlook. On the other hand, if they say to me, they read the New York Times, and they read the American Prospect, and they're a big fan of Bill Maher and all this, then I know they're coming from a different place. And it's shocking to me how rare it is that people will say, oh, I listen to both, read both, hear both. You just don't get that very often in American life these days. And I think you see that then reflected in the kind of politics we have. We have fewer swing districts when it comes to voting. There are fewer undecided voters. If you're a political strategist in Washington these days, the way that you manage your campaign is not by appealing to the middle so much as driving turnout among your base. And in order to drive turnout among your base, you are feeding people the kind of red meat that will excite them, and not necessarily speaking about your ability to be a statesman, a stateswoman, ability to govern in terms of what's best for the American people. So all of this contributes to a very difficult atmosphere in Washington where very little gets done. And then everybody says, oh my gosh, what are these idiots doing? But that's who we are at the moment.
What can be done about it? What can we do about it? And what can our elected officials do about it? What can the President of the United States do about it?
Well, I would say that the key thing is to come to know each other, to come and sit down and talk, and to go out of your way to know each other. I think people can make an aggressive, affirmative step to say, I want to know what other people are thinking. It's not a bad thing to know people who don't think in the way that you think. There's nothing illegitimate about it. It doesn't make you, you know, they have this phrase, rhino. It doesn't make you a Republican in name only because you want to talk to somebody. It doesn't make you some kind of traitor to the cause if you're a liberal who sits and hears what Rush Limbaugh has to say today. I think, in fact, it might open your ears and eyes and heart to the fact that there are different perspectives out there, and not all of them illegitimate. So I think that begins with the willingness to talk, to see, to hear. You know, one of the realities of America at this point, early in the 21st century, is there's a lot of self-sorting. We live with people of like mind. I think that some people call it birds of a feather flocking together, but this is now in terms of class, in terms of race, in terms of so many political affiliations. You know, you can tell where the Democrats are concentrated. Last election, what we saw is the Democrats actually got more votes than the Republicans when it came to the House of Representatives, but the Republicans got more seats. Why? Because the Democrats were concentrated in their districts, so they really aren't making a difference in so many of the Republican districts. And that tells you something about how we live. And the same can be said about how we watch TV, even in terms of the entertainment product. Movies, now done in terms of appealing to specific segments of the population. This is who we are, and I think in order to get beyond that, we have to start talking. Here I am in Texas, the home of LBJ, and you asked, you know, what can the president do? Well, so many people hold up President Johnson as the very personification of a president who was able to do business with people from the other party. But again, I think when you look back to that era, into the 60s, even with all of the antagonisms attached to the Vietnam War, to the civil rights movement, the women's movement, the disruptions on campus, what you see is that President Johnson had the capacity to make deals because there were people who were willing to make deals with him. There were Republicans who were willing to talk with him. You know, you think even of Ronald Reagan in the 80s. To me, I was covering that White House, it's not unusual to be walking out and see Tip O'Neill walking in. And Tip O'Neill and Reagan could sit and drink and talk, and two Irish guys making a deal.
This, for our students, was the Speaker of the House, who was a Democrat and Ronald Reagan a Republican president.
Why don't you just tell him how old I am? Why don't you just go right ahead?
He's really old.
So the idea that, you know, you could make a deal and not have to then pay for it because people in your party would punish you and say you're not a good leader, that was a reality not only for President Johnson, but it's a reality that subsequent presidents to some degree have had at their disposal. Today, I don't see that. I would say, again, in the spirit that I tried to express earlier to you of getting to know each other, talking to each other across these lines, I think it would be good if President Obama did more of reaching out even to people who have expressed antipathy to him. You know, I've heard him say, you know, he can stand in the line and take the pictures, you know, invite congressional Republicans to the picnic, they bring their family because they want to come to the White House, they want to have pictures and the like. But when they go back home to their districts, they don't ever admit that they've ever met him, right? Because it doesn't play well with their constituency. Nonetheless, I think it is imperative for him to make the effort and not give up. And some people say, well, you know, he's got young kids, he doesn't have time. I think if you're president, you better make time.
President Bush 41, by the way, under whom I was privileged to serve, would invite folks from the other side to Camp David.
Good idea.
And I even saw the President of the United States dipping ice cream. just that extra little human touch. Let's go back in time. It was a time of polarization, and yet things got done on Capitol Hill. And one of the great things that Juan has contributed to, in addition to his commentary on current events, what's happening now, is this great book, Eyes on the Prize, America's Civil Rights, 1954 to 1965. One of the reasons we're so honored that Juan is here, as I said at the outset, is because this year does mark the 50th anniversary of the signing of the 1964 Civil Rights Act by President Johnson. Very appropriately, on July the 2nd. Perhaps he wanted to do it on July the 4th, but it was on July the 2nd, pretty close. And this is a wonderful book, and it is, in fact, available to you. There is going to be a book signing afterwards. But let me ask just a broad question. Why is that statute so enduringly important even today?
Well, if you think about the Civil Rights Act of 64, let me put it in political and historical context for you. You know, this comes 10 years after 54 and the Brown decision. The Brown decision that Judge Starr spoke of as the leading decision of the Supreme Court in the 20th century. A ruling that really took apart, separate but equal, the 1896 Plessy v. Ferguson ruling that said the races could be separate and equal, and as Judge Starr said accurately, that formulation, that paradigm just didn't work because, yeah, they were separate, but clearly they were not equal. So you think about it in terms then, you know, sometimes I think some of these names, we're talking about commemorations, might help you. You know, recently there was a commemoration of Marian Anderson singing on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial because, again, she was not allowed to sing, simply perform at Constitution D.A.R. Hall in Washington, D.C. Or you think about something like, you know, this is the start of baseball season, Jackie Robinson back in 48. Or you come forward in time and, again, stop and think about, well, just, you know, so many of the individuals who, everything from Central, Little Rock Central High School, where President Eisenhower had to send the 101st Airborne in to defend the rights of those nine students, the Little Rock Nine, and you come to understand the immensity of the division in American life over the idea of segregation and legally enforced by the federal government, that the government will say, this is the law, separate but equal, knowing that there's a class of citizens who are being denied equal rights as it was articulated under the 14th Amendment, the post-Civil War amendments, one of the post-Civil War amendments. So here we come then to the argument, what about a new Civil Rights Act that would say we are about equal rights for all as Americans, that would in fact make that American principle real, put into law by the Congress of the United States. There had been previous attempts in the 50s and early 60s, and they had gone nowhere, nowhere. President Kennedy, after what had gone on in Birmingham in 63, after the death of Medgar Evers, assassinated in Mississippi, after the Great March on Washington, President Kennedy had gone before the American people and said, we are facing a moral crisis. We must do something. We must act. Again, it was going nowhere, zero. So when you stop and think about it, you know, if you're a student at Baylor today, you say, well, what's the big deal? They passed a law that said everybody has equal rights in the United States, and basically it comes down to you can stay in the hotel, you can eat at the restaurant, what's the big deal? That's Section 2. I think Section 7 says if you have a job, there should be no discrimination in terms of assignment or promotion. What's the big deal? You say, well, that's just the way we live. But in fact, it is a big deal. And it's a big deal because if you go back, and I think, you know, this is the advantage of a great institution like Baylor, where you can go back and dig in a little bit on the history, you see people making the case that, wait a minute, that's not in keeping with American values. I have the right to associate with who I want to associate with. Why do I have to sit down and talk to this white guy? You know, I should be able to do whatever I want. If I want to eat with white people, if I want to go to church with black people, I can do what I want to do. And of course, it fits into this paradigm of separate but equal. And they're saying, you can't force me to associate with people that I don't want to associate with. And secondly, there was a more powerful emotional argument, particularly in the South, because we're coming just years after Brown and massive resistance to school integration. There was this emotional outpouring that said, this is really about the federal government getting into our business. They're getting into violating our state's rights, and they want to tell us what to do, and they want to advance this cause of race mixing. I mean, this had real power, and what you had was an inability of the Congress then to get anything done. And even President Kennedy, who we remember as, you know, charismatic, you know, couldn't do anything with it. It wasn't going anywhere. So I think for young people today, when you think about how history is made, how something that was done 50 years ago would be celebrated with Judge Starr and I sitting here today talking about it, you have to understand that you are going to be required to get your hands dirty. You're going to have to take on some emotional arguments. You're going to have to take on powerful foes. In this case, when we're talking about the Civil Rights Act, Strom Thurmond filibustered for 24 hours. And you had people like Barry Goldwater, a Republican, but Senator Byrd, a Democrat, Senator Byrd of Virginia, you know, say, absolutely not. And of course, President Johnson said, once the bill was passed, he thought that meant that the Democrats would lose the South for a generation or more. And we've seen the South become solid Republican territory. So if you have a question, you might say, well, gosh, why are they focusing on the Civil Rights Act? You have to understand that it really was an earthquake in terms of American life. It really shook us. And to this day, just last week, the arguments over affirmative action.
In the Michigan case.
In the Michigan case. Again, a reflection of what happened back in 64. That was one of the points of criticism. Oh, now they want to give stuff away to these minorities. And the proponents of the 64 Act, maybe this comes as a surprise to you, had to say, oh, no. We're not talking about any percentage or ratios. This has nothing to do with that. We simply want to enforce the 14th Amendment that it would protect blacks and whites equally from discrimination. So, but nonetheless, that is the root of so many of these arguments that are so real today about race in American society.
You talked about getting your hands dirty, and this wonderful book, Eyes on the Prize, lifts up the unsung heroes, those who have been largely lost to history, but who paved the way for, by their brave acts, for what Congress was eventually called upon and did. Talking about getting your hands dirty, another book by Juan Williams, Dean Garland mentioned it, Thurgood Marshall, American Revolutionary. One of the great lawyers, one of the great justices. It's a great photo of Thurgood Marshall in his 40s, I would estimate perhaps in his early 50s. Very striking man, very, very brave. And you paint in this book a very vivid portrait of the justice. Growing up in Baltimore, he had a very intriguing background. And then he goes off to college, and things happen to him in college at Lincoln University. We like to talk about college as transformational, and we think it is here at Baylor. Describe how this young man from Baltimore, heading up a ways to Lincoln University, changed during the course of his college career.
Well, this is one of these stories you hesitate to tell. It's not that I'm trying to besmirch his reputation, but you have to understand he was a party animal. He was a frat boy, and that's all. That's just the fact. He's a frat boy. He's having a good time. He's all about. I mean, growing up in Baltimore, remember, in segregated schools, and because they're segregated and there were, it concentrates interactions in the black community. So you might be curious, but he's in high school with Cab Calloway, the scat singer, mm-hmm. And they're going off to the racetrack, having a great time. And famous jazz musicians and singers are regulars in his life. It's just very fascinating. But he goes off to college, to Lincoln University in Pennsylvania, a black college, and it's founded by the Presbyterian Church. At the time, Lincoln was called the Black Princeton because Princeton was similarly founded by the Presbyterians, but it was founded for white men, Lincoln for black men. And both were stellar schools, fine faculty. Here comes young Thurgood Marshall, wanting to be one of the guys, wanting to prove he can be just as wild and crazy as anybody else. Gets terribly injured at one point, just a terrible injury. But nonetheless, always up to hijinks. I hesitate to tell you this story given who I'm sitting next to, but keep in mind that he was the kind of college student who would lead a cow into the president's office and give that cow Epsom salt so that it would have, yes, and mess all over the president's carpet. I'm not giving out any ideas, but I'm just telling you the kind of person we're dealing with here. So this was Mr. Prankster, Mr. Funny Man. This was Thurgood Marshall. But one of the people who comes into his life during his junior year is a student coming back to Lincoln. And, you stop and think, I mentioned to you before about Cab Calloway, but here comes the poet, the writer, Langston Hughes, coming back to school to get to finish his degree at Lincoln. And at this point, Langston Hughes has been traveling the world. He's been on ships. He's been writing poetry. He's already been published, but he wants to finish his education. And he runs into Mr. Party Animal, Mr. Big Man on campus, Thurgood Marshall. And he's like, Thurgood, you were always talking about the latest party and the biggest prank, but I never hear you talk about the fact that there are no black people on the faculty here at Lincoln. It was the Black Princeton, but when it comes to faculty, only white faculty. And Thurgood Marshall's gut response was, oh, well, if we have black people on the faculty, you don't know how people at Hampton, at Howard, at the other high-level black schools are going to react. It would be such a change. He doesn't have any social, political, even, you would argue, racial consciousness at this. He's just accepting this as the reality of his world at that moment. So Langston Hughes persists and tries to get a vote of the student body on this issue, whether or not to allow black people to serve on the faculty at Lincoln University. And without gaining the support of the fraternities, at that point being led by young Thurgood Marshall, the vote goes down pretty badly. Langston Hughes leaves, but Thurgood Marshall comes back for his senior year, and he comes back with a different attitude. And suddenly, in the student paper, when I'm doing this research, you can find Thurgood Marshall quoted as saying, if we don't accept black people as our teachers, how can we expect to graduate, go on to law school, go on to dental school, go on to medical school, and ask other black people to accept us as their lawyers, their dentists, their doctors? Isn't it time that we allow qualified men and women to teach us, men and women of color, to teach us here at Lincoln? And this time, he manages to get the fraternities to support him, and this time it passes, and a few years later, the first black person comes on to the faculty at Lincoln. And in just the way that Judge Starr talks about coming to Baylor being a transforming experience for a young mind, but also for a young spirit, you can see this transformation occurring in young Thurgood Marshall. As I'm writing his biography, you start to see that he has an awareness now of the world in which he lives in. Rather than trying to simply conform, fit in, now he's starting to understand that he wants to break out a little bit, that he wants to leave his mark, that there's something for him to do. And part of that is that he wants to become a lawyer. He now sees that there is some mission, some purpose in the law, that the law is not simply a matter of fixed principles, but the law is something that is used by the American people to establish the idea of equality of rights. And he wants to be a part of that. And that's why he goes off to law school.
And then the career that we honor, a magnificent career. I had the privilege of knowing Justice Marshall both when I was a law clerk at the court and to argue cases before Justice Marshall. And just one quick aside, one of the favorite parts of the day for law clerks at the Supreme Court was what was called story time. It was at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and law clerks from other chambers were welcome to sit with Justice Marshall, who was truly a great raconteur. He knew how to tell stories, and he loved having that time for 30 minutes or 35 minutes or so with the law clerks. And he wouldn't tell stories about himself. He would tell stories about others. So he was truly a great man, very courageous. He had some experiences right here in Texas. One of which, why don't you tell, if you would, that story, because there was a black college president in Dallas, and he was seeking to serve on a jury, but he was being excluded. In fact, someone in the courthouse actually threw the college president down the stairs, which I don't think is a very nice thing to do. And I hope everybody will forget the cow story. And Epsom salt. Tell that story, because there was a remarkable, including the governor of the state of Texas became involved to lend a helping hand.
So this is 1938 in Dallas, and this is a community college president, George Porter, and George Porter wants to serve on a jury, and he is summoned, as people are summoned to jury service to this day. And goes into the jury pool, and there are other black people in the jury pool. But the practice was that once the jury pool was visible to the judge, that all blacks would be excluded, would be dismissed. But Porter very much wanted to be the first black to serve on a jury in Dallas, and understood the normal procedure. And the procedure was as followed, that once the lunch break was called, the white members of the jury pool would go out to lunch, but the black members of the jury pool would be instructed to go into a room, oftentimes a very dark room, and there would be a certain threatening atmosphere, and then the deputy would say, those of you who want to leave, feel free to do so. Well, most people would get out of a sort of dark, scary place, and they did, and then that was it. Well, Porter didn't leave, and instead says to the deputy, I would like to see the judge. I don't want to be dismissed from this jury. I want to serve. And the deputy harumphs and is resistant, but eventually Porter makes his way back into the courtroom, finds the judge. The judge says, well, you can file an appeal, but it's too late for you to serve on this jury. So sorry. See you later. And Porter says, no, I knew you were going to do that, so I've already filed the appeal. And so there's an appeal pending, and you can't have your trial unless you deal with this issue. At which point, the deputy reappears, and as you've heard from Judge Starr, begins pushing and shoving Porter down the hall, and eventually kicks him down the steps. And he picks himself up, he's bruised, the suit has holes in it now, and he and the deputy get into it, but he is gone. But he then contacts the newspapers. It becomes a story throughout Texas, and it catches the attention of Thurgood Marshall, who is just the new leader of the NAACP's Legal Defense Fund office, this young lawyer in New York, and he decides he wants to take on this case. The problem is that the local police chief, hearing about Thurgood Marshall being interested in this case, because Marshall is shooting off his mouth about going down to Texas, straightening this out, says that he personally will kick Thurgood Marshall's ass if he ever shows up in Dallas. And so Thurgood Marshall, I remember talking to him about this, and it's just as Judge Starr said, he's terrific. Judge Starr is such an educated man, he uses the word raconteur. I would say he's a good storyteller. Thurgood Marshall, Thurgood Marshall said, you know, I wasn't sure. Once I heard that the police chief was promising to kick my butt, I thought, you know, maybe it was better if I didn't go right now. Maybe I would, you know, see if I could, like, get a cold, but I couldn't catch one. So he comes down after first phoning the governor, James Allred. He phones Governor Allred, and Governor Allred says, you will be fine here. You have no reason to worry. And I'll give you protection. I'll assign a Texas Ranger to protect you the minute you get off the plane. Well, when Marshall lands in Dallas, there, just as the governor promised, is a Texas Ranger. But the Texas Ranger begins by calling him boy. And Marshall thinks, this is not what I was in for here. As he gets the governor on the phone, the governor says, this guy's terrific. You're not going to have a problem. Just put me on the line with him. And sure enough, they have a conversation. And the Texas Ranger looks like his head's going to explode. And he starts, Lawyer Marshall, my apologies. We're going to be fine. Marshall then begins negotiating with the chief judge and lawyers here in Texas on this issue of blacks serving on the jury. About 3 days in, he's coming out of the courthouse, and who does he see but the chief of police, gun drawn, approaching him, and Marshall, who was never afraid to tell you that he was a big scaredy cat, went running towards the car where the Texas Ranger was sitting on the hood. The Texas Ranger, seeing this commotion, reacts, and he stands between Marshall and the sheriff, and Marshall, by this point, is in the car, leaving the two of them outside, and the sheriff backs down. Marshall is able to complete his business, and it's only a matter of a month or two later that the first black person is able to serve on a jury in Dallas.
It takes courage, even if you turn and run and get in the car. Yeah. But he knew that he was going to face danger, and he faced danger frequently, didn't he? But culminating in his career with the magnificent victory in Brown versus Board of Education. And soon the talk began that perhaps Justice Marshall, the future justice, should be a judge. He turned down the opportunity to be a federal district court judge, but then he was nominated and served with great distinction for a period of time. the United States Court of Appeals for the Second Circuit. So by the time the 1964 Civil Rights Act was passed, Judge Marshall was not on the scene, but someone else had come on the scene, a powerful figure in American life, Martin Luther King, Jr. And we honor the I Have a Dream speech and the example of the Christian, very expressed Christian vision. I have frequently said that every American should read April 16, 1963, letter from a Birmingham jail. So Judge Marshall is comfortably sitting in Foley Square, New York, as a judge at this time. And Martin Luther King Jr. is in jail. And he writes this remarkable letter about why he is doing what he is doing in the civil rights movement. And it's a letter to his fellow members of the clergy. With that, for whatever reason, Judge Marshall, Thurgood Marshall, didn't seem to care that much for Martin Luther King Jr.'s techniques or tactics. Tell us about that. You talk about that again in this wonderful book.
You know, there's so many surprises, but one of the realities is divisions within the ranks of the civil rights movement. And again, you come back to the idea that once you are 50 years at a remove, you think, oh, well, gee, all these folks got along. They all agreed. They were all working for the same cause. Well, of course not. They didn't all agree. And in fact, the NAACP was the brand name in terms of civil rights organizations and activism. And when Thurgood Marshall, who has won the Brown decision, and is a national figure, been on the cover of Time magazine, hears about this young minister who's involved in a bus boycott down in Montgomery, Alabama. You know, he assigns somebody else to go work with him on this bus boycott issue. He's off. He's, at that point, he was just, his first wife had died. He's getting remarried. He comes back, and this thing is all over the newspapers, this bus boycott, and this charismatic minister. Well, that charismatic minister then rises up in American life. He becomes the focus of so much media attention. It's like where Martin Luther King Jr. goes, the cameras go, the newspaper reporters go, and also the money goes. And this becomes a direct threat to the NAACP that Martin Luther King is now a magnet for dollars coming from supporters of the civil rights movement. And that money was previously flowing to the NAACP. In addition to which, though, and I think this is what Judge Starr is referring to, Marshall was of the mind that real change in a society takes place in terms of its laws. That if you really want permanent change in a society, you want the courts on your side, you want the legislature on your side. You want to make your case in a democratic way to these institutions. And this young man, this Martin Luther King Jr., he's a wonderful speaker. Wonderful. You hear a speech by King, hear I Have a Dream, and it brings tears to your eyes. He seems to speak from the heart when he speaks about judging people not on the basis of their skin color, but on the content of their character. When he talks about not only justice rolling down like a mighty stream, but righteousness pouring down upon us as American people. Just a powerful speaker. But Thurgood Marshall hears this, and he thinks, you know, you can hear a Dr. King speech and go home to total segregation and be unable to get a job. You can go home to segregated schools where you are given an inferior education. You can go home and not be able to get medical care in case of an emergency that would take you to a segregated hospital. What you need to do is address the concrete element, something that is permanent, and that is the law. And that's the way he viewed Martin Luther King Jr. He wasn't a supporter of the Great March on Washington for just this reason, because it was threatening the Congress and the politics surrounding the potential passage of the 64 Civil Rights Act. And you'll find that there are people of goodwill and good intent who just had a different view, who who were right at the heart of the civil rights movement. But again, I think it's important, especially for young people, to understand the difficulties and divisions, even among people of like mind with common goals.
Did it take them both to bring about the civil rights movement?
Oh, I don't think there's any question. And, you know, the way I think of it, Judge Starr, is I don't think Thurgood Marshall understood the poetry, the music, the spiritual aspect that Martin Luther King brought to the movement. The idea that social change was happening in the streets, that was not Thurgood Marshall's province. He was in the courtroom. He was working with judges. He was someone who could stand and sit in conversation with elected officials. You were Solicitor General. He was a Solicitor General. He understood that world. The world of people gathered in a church basement trying to figure out on the fly how to mount a movement, that was not him. I don't know that he couldn't have done it, but it's not his worldview. I'll just for a second stop here and say that when we spoke earlier about Lincoln, he goes on from Lincoln to Howard University Law School. And when he goes there, he meets a man who was the dean of that law school, which at the time was not a very good school because it was a nighttime, part-time operation. But this man, Charles Hamilton Houston, wanted to transform the school to make it a full-time, fully accredited, daytime operation with a quality faculty. And his reasoning was there were only about 1,000 black lawyers in the country. This is in the late 1920s. And what he wanted to do was to create, if you will, a West Point for black lawyers, where you could get some fine legal minds at work at changing the laws so that equality under the law would be possible for black people. Thurgood Marshall was of that school of thinking, that is how you went into this. You know, in Star Wars terms, if the force be with you as you went up against this huge structure of legal segregation in the society, the thought was, if we can just get the law on our side, we can win. I think that for Martin Luther King Jr., it was much more, if we can get our fellow Christians on our side to see that we are all God's children, no matter what our race, then we can win. Just a different point of view of the critical moment to be achieved.
In the time that remains, and before your questions, and you do have the opportunity to write questions down, and we'll be propounding those. That's a fancy word meaning we'll be asking Juan those questions. This is what happens when you go to law school.
I must Juan. Be.
I don't think we're going to get into the Baylor Law School, Dean Tobin. I'd like to go all the way forward and bring you all the way forward to the 21st century and Nelson Mandela, another great hero of those who stand for human rights. And you did something that was extraordinary. I think Nelson Mandela counted you as a friend, or at least someone who was pretty special to him. Tell us the story as to how you connected in such a deep way with the great man.
Well, this is sort of one of those Forrest Gump moments, but you know, as a journalist, these things happen to you. I was asked by the Washington Post to go to South Africa when Mandela was being released from prison. And the Post had a correspondent there covering the daily events, but the idea was to do a piece that would help people to have the broader perspective of a nation at a critical moment of change, the release of Nelson Mandela from prison. Well, so I land and, you know, you can't go out to where he was being held in prison, but he was coming home to the house he had left in Soweto and his wife, Winnie Mandela. And so I appealed to the officials. You know, I'm from Washington, D.C., the Washington Post. It would mean so much to us if we could have an interview. And I was told, look, you know, the reality is that everybody from, Walter Cronkite, types, you know, Peter Jennings, Brokaw, Rather, they're all there. You know, and it's not just the American top journalists from all over the world, and newspaper journalists, and they're not even dealing with news, they're dealing with TV folks for the most part. And just, you know, there really wasn't an opportunity to deal with somebody who was from a big newspaper, the Washington Post, but is doing a feature story. Sorry. But then it turns out that there's a list made up of people who want to meet with Mr. Mandela, and my name appeared on the list. And Mandela, seeing my name, said, wait a second, that guy wrote Eyes on the Prize. Mm. And turns out he had read the book in prison. Somebody had sent him this book about the American Civil Rights Movement. In all honesty, he's one of the few people I ever met who read the book before he saw the TV series. So he arranges for me to be put in the line of people who are just being brought through like dignitaries to shake hands because so many people want to see him. So he gets out of prison, gets home, and I'm in this line with like ambassadors and officials to shake hands. So when I get up there to shake his hand, I say, oh, Mr. Mandela, you don't know, it would mean so much to us to have a moment of time with you, Washington Post, big newspaper in our nation's capital. And I don't know if you've ever seen like Showtime at the Apollo where they give a comedian the literal hook to get him out of there, but people are pulling my jacket to say, let his hand go. And I won't let his hand go, but finally, courtesy requires me to move on. And just as I'm about to disappear out the door, I hear him say, hold on, you're a writer. And I'm getting a lot of congratulatory telegrams and messages, and I don't have a corresponding secretary. If you'd like to help me, you can hang around. I'll talk to you when I can. I said, absolutely, it's a deal. So I end up writing some ridiculous notes. I mean ridiculous. Things like, thank you, Comrade Gorbachev. Great to be out. Hope to see you soon. Love, Nelson. So I'm pecking away writing these notes, but the payoff is I get to sit with him when he's having lunch and dinner, grandchildren, friends, visiting dignitaries, the big reporters. I get to sit and talk and watch. And just an incredible experience because you get to see history up close and you get to see somebody who, you know, at one point I said to him, Mr. Mandela, you know, in the United States and all the world, we see you as an icon, you know, a leader of this liberation movement in South Africa, this great hero who sacrificed so much of his life. He'd been in jail all these years. And we imagine that, you know, you had this revolutionary spirit from the time you were a child. And that's the one time, Judge Starr, that I heard him laugh. And I thought, I think he didn't understand what I had to say. Maybe it's like, you know, an American colloquialism, the way I put it or something, but why is this guy laughing? And I said, oh, I don't think you understood, sir. And no, he said, no, I get it. He says, it's just so funny to me that people think that I was born this way. I mean, he said, you know, when he was a kid, all he wanted to do was rebel against his parents, not the state. That was his problem. He just wanted to get out. If he had simply stayed where he was in his tribal situation, he would have grown up because he was royalty. He would have been a prince. He wanted to go to the big city. He wanted to become a boxer. He loved boxing. One of the points of curiosity in our whole exchange was about Mike Tyson, who was then, in fact, just losing, but he was the rage in boxing at the time. He wants to know about Ronald Reagan. He wants to know about American politics. Anyway, he says to me, when he was a kid, all he wanted to do was go to the bright lights of the big city. He wanted to not only be a boxer, he wanted to be a poet. And then he wanted to get what he called, I think you'll appreciate this at Baylor, a Western-style liberal arts education. Mm. And so he goes on to become educated. He then goes on to law school. Even his friends can't understand why he would want to go to law school. You know, why do you want to study the laws in a country where a black lawyer is never going to have any power? This is an apartheid country. He gets his law degree. And then he talks about trying to just do his job as a lawyer and being frustrated by the apartheid system. And finally, becoming involved with the African National Congress and being surprised that people respond to his speeches, and that maybe even more so the response from the government, which sees him as a threat, eventually puts him in the dock on these charges, and then sends him away to Robben's Island to break stones. And the thing that strikes me to this moment is, while most politicians I meet are such driven, angry type of persons, this was a guy who you would sit and trust, because he was so low-key, at times, as I say, not given to quick burst of humor, but not given to any anger, not given to telling you his views, but always trying to extract from you information, a sense of trust just emanating from him. That's who I came to learn was this great world leader. He was a large man with these big, powerful, and yet soft hands, but not someone who, the minute he walked in the room, you would say, oh my God, he's larger than life, he's dominating. It's that you knew who he was, and you knew what he had done, and his capacity for discipline, self-sacrifice, and unrelenting purpose. And in that sense, you just became enamored and it almost felt protective of him. And I think that's one of the great distinctions that I keep in mind, because as I say, I deal with political leaders on a daily basis, and that's why he stands out to me. It wasn't anything forced by him. It was simply the power of, I hesitate to say it, but the power of goodness that came from this individual that made him so inspiring.
Join me in saying thank you to Juan Williams as we now move to your questions. And welcome. To the podium, Tiffany Hogue.
You have said a faith-based debate is not in the spirit of the separation of church and state. Can you explain that? How can thoughtful Christians balance their religious convictions with the First Amendment?
I think that there's a need here to understand that faith is to be incorporated into our First Amendment understanding. That when we talk about religious liberty, when we talk about the notion of freedom of speech and ideas, that part of that is understanding the rigorous adherence to points of religious faith and to Christian doctrine, in my case, a belief in Christ, and an understanding that how Christ can be generous, can be welcoming, can be accepting of other points of view. So when we talk about differences and debate as in terms of First Amendment rights, I find it totally fitting with my Christian faith that allows me never to be the one to sit in judgment. I believe there is a God and there is a Christ and there is a sense of a judgment, but it's not mine to judge. It's mine to take advantage, in much the way you would talk about the talents, take advantage of the talents God has given, to hear, to welcome, to work with one church working together, the human family, to accomplish things and to reach to new heights in God's name in my life.
Thank you. Mr. Williams, would you care to comment upon the action that the NBA has taken in response to the racist remarks made by LA Clippers owner Donald Sterling this past week?
Sure. I mean, I'm a big NBA fan, and I think that, I mean, on two levels I have concerns here. One is, and you know, this is, you know, people can debate the privacy issue, you know, someone speaking privately. I think that it said that he was having his mistress, his friend, create some kind of oral history at his request. But even if that's the case, it was not a public statement. It was a private statement. But the statement was so odious and so difficult to accept that you can understand why people who are in business with him might want to react. Now, clearly, he didn't violate any law. he didn't violate any kind of, he didn't take any action that the public could sanction. It was up to his colleagues, his peers, as owners of National Basketball Association teams and the commissioner of the league under the league bylaws to then deal with him. And they decided then to support the commissioner in terms of imposing this lifetime ban, and I guess it's $2.5 million fine on Donald Sterling. My feeling is good. What you want is people who are in business, who are in community with someone, who behaves in this fashion, to get a very clear, unequivocal message. That is not healthy for our society. It does not build us, it does not strengthen us, it does not bring us closer to a common spirit. It has to be a very clear, unequivocal message that no matter how you fall on the political lines, rich, poor, 1%, 99%, I don't care, this is not in keeping with our values, and our values count. And so I thought that the commissioner's action was tremendous, but it could be challenged in court, and we'll see how the courts interpret the NBA bylaws. Apparently, the commissioner has no trouble with the other owners. The other owners have all voiced support. It hasn't yet to be a dissident voice saying, no, we think the commissioner overstepped the bounds of his authority. So overall, I think it's been a really important moment for us as an American people. And one added point, which, you know, I was initially disappointed in the athletes, because the athletes, they took off their jerseys or whatever, but I thought, boy, you know, they have such an opportunity to speak out here and say there's something terrible. Instead, it's much to me like the rappers. You know, they say, oh, well, I'm making a lot of money. I heard Charles Barkley say on TV, oh, you know, I play for myself, I play for my teammates, but I certainly don't play for the owner. Fine, I don't care who you play for. The message you're sending is this game or this paycheck that I get for playing this game is more important than making a statement about how we live in this society. And I thought that was very troubling. So I'm pleased that I then later heard that the players were contemplating taking more severe action if the commissioner, they felt, had simply evaded or tried to avoid dealing with this issue. But I thought that it would have been better in keeping with personalities like ranging from, you know, Arthur Ashe to Muhammad Ali, if these black athletes, I think like 70%+ of the NBA is made up of black athletes, if they had raised their voices.
Thank you. 4 weeks ago today, there was yet another mass shooting at Fort Hood, located just 60 miles from here. You stated in response to that tragedy that America should be a gun-free zone. Can you expand on that?
Sure. I got to tell you, this is a little more personal as I'm telling it to you now than it would be if I told it to you a few weeks ago, because just this last weekend, my wife went to the gas station, and while she was at the gas station, you know, you put the credit card into the gas pump now to pay, somebody brushed by her, jumped in the car, and drove away with the car. Stole the car, her keys, her glasses, her cell phone, everything. And, you know, when I showed up to get her and deal with the cops and the detectives and the crime scene people, everything, you know, she was in a fury, and she said she wished she had a gun. So, let me tell you, I know who's the first person she'd shoot, too. So, you know, Myris, it was interesting. The police said to her, don't say that in front of us. And my feeling was, you know, what are you talking about? You know, I mean, if it had been in your purse, then he would have the gun, you know, or something like, I mean, come on. But anyway, to come back to your question, so my feeling as someone who lives in a big city, and I grew up in New York City, I then went to school in Philadelphia, and I live in Washington, D.C., is that one of my fears is that some punk with a gun, you know, is going to stick me up, or I'm going to somehow find myself driving or walking through some field of fire as some gang is having some back and forth, some turf war or something. Guns do not comfort me. They do not, in any sense, encourage me to feel that I am protecting my family and self. I'm very well aware of statistics that say that if my wife did have a gun, that I'm the most likely victim of her gun use. That's not just anecdotal, that's a fact. So my sense is that, you know, I think people take a lot of comfort in guns, especially in big cities. But when I hear about something like what happened in Newtown, when I see the kind of carnage that's a regular feature of life in big cities these days, and by the way, most of it is young black men killing young black men, I just think, God, I don't know why we have this mania with guns. And I don't expect that I'm in a group of people being here in Texas who agree with me, but I'm just telling you from the heart, I do wish that there was a reconsideration of the idea that everybody is entitled to an arsenal, and that you run into people like this guy who went into the FedEx facility recently in Atlanta, and he's dressed like, you know, G.I. Joe, a commando, and he's got grenade or explosives and multiple weapons and rapid fire weaponry better suited for a war. I just don't get it. It seems to me very threatening to my, I don't know if it's a right, Judge, you might have to help me here, but if I have a right to safety in my daily activities. And one last thing is that being in public as much as I am and having so many people disagree with me vehemently as they do, I really don't think it's a good idea.
Thank you. One final question. What words of wisdom do you have for the young people in the audience tonight?
Well, the key thing it always comes to me is that even here at Baylor, even at the top level of American higher education, I think that you're going to find that the person you are right now is nowhere near the person you are going to be. Writing about young Justice Marshall, no idea that he could change American society, change the laws of the country. Talking with Judge Starr about young Nelson Mandela, no idea that he would grow into this worldwide light for people involved in freedom struggles and calls for social equality. And this is true across the board as I encounter people. So in many ways, if you're a student here at Baylor tonight, and you know your friends say, oh, you know, you're not going to do this or you can't do that, maybe even you're the best student at Baylor, and your professors and your parents are so proud of you. But at some point, you're going to have to even break away from their expectations for what that ladder, career ladder for you might look like. And it may not be that you break away, it could be that circumstances, fate, opportunity takes you down a different path. All of that is going to occur. And rather than say, oh my gosh, I really need a job, and I want a job that pays a certain amount of money, and I want a house that looks like this, and I want a car that looks like that, and I want a gravestone that looks like this in the right section of the cemetery, forget all that. I think the key thing is, and this is the blessing of a liberal arts education, you're hearing this from a philosophy major whose mother never got it, who always said, what kind of job does a philosophy major get? The key thing is to be open and to be willing to surprise yourself. Don't worry about what the other classmates are going to think when you come back for the reunion in 10, 20, 30, 50 years. Come back with a sense that, you know what, when I was at Baylor, I had no idea. I had no clue. Who would have guessed? I'll tell you from my own personal experience in this way. I had a cousin, and the cousin saw me on TV one day. And then I was visiting back in New York, and he came over to me and said, "You know, I never knew you had anything to say." And that's from growing up in a family where people are screaming and dinner was like a shout fest, and I really didn't have anything. I was the baby. I was the youngest one. So in a sense, you know, it's not the relatives, it's not the friends, and I don't even think it's the professors. I think it has to do with you, and I think it has to always do with the just protecting the sense, you know what, I'm living this one life God has given me, and I'm going to use it, and I'm going to surprise myself, I'm going to travel, I'm going to learn languages, I'm going to meet people who are strange and different, and I'm going to have a hell of a good time.
Ladies and gentlemen, Juan Williams.
Yes.
That was fun.
Thank you, Bill. Appreciate it.
And he will be out.
Thank you. That's very nice.
Thank oh, good. Look, you do. Take a bow. You're getting a standing ovation.
Thank you very much, Bill. Thank you. Thanks.
Do you think Juan should return to Baylor? He will see you in the foyer where he'll be signing books. Thank you so much, and thank you, Tiffany Hoag, for standing in for Elizabeth.